try to catch a plane in a little, just a few minutes, to go to Washington, and get into Washington at the Reagan National Airport, they have to get there at a certain time. So I gotta get there at a certain time, which means I gotta leave in a hurry. So let me just say a few things, I'm very happy I've been here, Mr. Mayor, and Mr. President, and Jackson, and really all of these. This is a great place, I've always loved Orangeburg, and I say that as a little boy, my mama's sister, Elizabeth Darwin, was married to Claude Martin. Claude Martin, born and raised in Franceville, and he had a place out on the head, it's still called Turkey Bend, years ago. And we used to go down there and sit around and fish, and play in the little lodge, I guess you'd call it, he had, and run from the snakes, and it was just, one time we got in a boat going down the river, and went up under some bushes, doggone snake didn't drop into the boat, what was in it? But it'll get your attention, I promise you that. Orangeburg has got great potential for the future, and that's will be my very brief message to you, because of the time. But South Carolina, the whole of South Carolina is that way. And having been in public service for a while, I've had the opportunity, particularly in the lieutenant governor's office and the governor's office, to meet with people all over the world who are coming in to look at South Carolina to see if they want to invest a few hundred million or $1 billion. And I tell you, it's been instructive, because often we don't see ourselves as others see. We're used to living in paradise, and we don't realize we're living in paradise. And often, like you heard the story about the city slicker who went to the circus, and he saw a huge jumbo elephant over there. He was tethered to a little small stake with a little small chain wrapped around his leg. And the city slicker says to the ringmaster, he said, "What's that elephant, if you have him tethered on that small chain, he could just walk off with that thing and not even notice it. How are y'all doing like that?" He said, "Well, when he was a baby, we put that chain on him, and he tried and tried and couldn't get loose, and now he's grown up and he doesn't realize that he can break loose, so he doesn't try it." Well, that is what I think is holding a lot of people back around the country. And it is a tyranny of limited expectations. I've heard the presidents of Carolina, USC, as well as Clemson, are the ones that have been so vocal about it, saying, and the Clemson president a few years ago said, "I'm tired of hearing people say South Carolina is a small, poor state and we can't do anything." He said, "I never want to hear it again." And to that I say amen, because it's not true. And the proof of the lack of truth in that statement is what I have seen, maybe you've seen it too, in these companies that want to come to South Carolina. We have a lot of things we have to do. We have a lot we have to do in education. We have to keep the taxes low. When you keep taxes low, businesses invest, people get hired. When people get hired, people have good jobs. And I've seen it as Attorney General and way back as U.S. Attorney working under Ronald Reagan, who is a truly great man, but I have seen it. When people are working, when the economy is on the rise, when people get up in the morning and they're ready to go to work and they're looking forward to it, and they're getting a paycheck to take care of the family, when all that is happening, when we're going spiraling up instead of spiraling down, what happens? Domestic violence goes down, crime goes down, the use of drugs goes down, marriages go up, divorces go down. It's all in a positive cycle, and that's where we are now. So to get to the end of the story real quick, what we have to do is be sure we don't mess it up. Because people have worked in this state for a lot of years and have built institutions on this great paradise that we were given by a good Lord, and which was recognized by all the explorers when they were coming over back in the 15 and 1600s. All of them were writing back to their sovereign saying, "We've never seen anything like the place that we today call South Carolina." Every one of them was saying that. And all of those assets are still here. And on top of that, we have built others. And that is what is attracting these big businesses. I want you to understand, attracting big businesses is not the only thing that we need to be doing. But it is, and it's about all the time I've got to talk to you, perhaps I'm going to dwell on that. But also that economic development, that prosperity is the key to happiness in the future of the people of this state. And when we are growing, when we have good jobs, everything else, as I mentioned, tends to get better and better. So what do these people from other places say? They say, yes, it is true, the research universities which collaborate in partnership with businesses, that's a very important thing. We have three of them, USC, University of South Carolina, and Clemson. Most other states, you don't have that close communication and collaboration among the research universities and these highly sophisticated companies that are coming in. Data analytics, the National Data Analytics Headquarters, the IBM is on the corner of Blossom and Assembly Street in Columbia. We have Siemens, Magnificent Corporation, recently gave $624 million worth of engineering hardware or software to the University of South Carolina. They have confidence in the university, professors, the young people, the young bright minds. They will collaborate on all this sort of engineering. This could take us even farther off the scale. ICAR up at Clemson, off the scale of engineering development and technology. We have all these research universities that cooperate with each other and collaborate with the businesses, and that gives the businesses something they can't get anywhere else. What else do we have? Great technical college. It started in 1961. No other state has anything like what we have. It's been recognized all over the planet, all over the planet. And Wilbur Ross, the current Secretary of Commerce, U.S. Secretary of Commerce, said twice when we were welcoming Samsung, which is a big company, to Newberry, South Carolina. I repeat, Samsung in Newberry, South Carolina. This is the community. In D.C. and having a ceremony up there. And Wilbur Ross says, South Carolina has the best workforce development programs of any state in the country. So it's a model for the rest of the country. And so we have that technical college system. One thing we have to do with the people is have to dispel an old myth that you must have a four-year college degree in order to be successful. Not true. And not true at all. I've been to these, you know, there's a lot of folks, that's what they want to do, and for their career path, they would need that four-year degree in their subjects. But ladies and gentlemen, in these big plants today, in these companies with the innovation they have today, the workers in there don't carry toolboxes anymore, they carry laptop computers. I mean, people, there's money, there's great jobs that take skills, that take training, but it's higher education. At its very best, and you can have people going from high school to get a two-year degree in a technical college and go to work right away. Some of them will come back and get other certificates, and they're happy, and they're doing what they want to do. They're using their mind and their hands. They're making money, they're having families. We've got 22-year-olds buying houses in South Carolina, and they got no college debt because they went to the technical college. I'm not saying get rid of the research universities in the 4 years. You hear that back there, Mr. President? I'm not saying you really.
I'm waiting. I'll give you a minute.
We have to supplement that and understand that our young people, many of them want to do that. I mean, it's highly skilled, it's sophisticated, it's educated well. For example, young man in Columbia, down on his luck, he essentially homeless. Somebody talked him into going to get his GED, which he did, and he went to leave his Midlands Tech, got a associate degree in welding. Went to work at about $75,000 welding. We got right now, we have 60,000 jobs looking for people to work in South Carolina. Some of them in welding, others in truck driving, electrician, HVAC, all those things. And they're paying much more money than they used to. But then the young man came back and got a certificate in nuclear welding. And in the period of about 3.5 years, he'd gone from homeless on the street, not a cent to his name, to making over $100,000. And he's happy. And he's welding. And that's what he wants to do. He doesn't want to study French literature. Doesn't care much about chemistry. What he wants to do is weld. He's happy to do it. So it's a real success story. Those are two of the assets. What's another one? Now, Port of Charleston, just down the street. It's deep, it's getting deeper, it's wide enough, folks can go in and out two at a time. We're going to 55 feet, and that means that we in New York and New Jersey in a few years will be the dominant ports on the Atlantic coast. How do you spell port? M-O-E-D-Y. Not only do we have one of the best ports, and this is important because they've opened up, redone the Panama Canal, So these big ships can come through and everything coming up the Atlantic coast. Y'all seen those big ships? You seen the container ships with all of, you know how many of those containers to a big ship? $13,000, $14,000 That's big time. And these companies are looking for ports. They want to be able to get things in and get things out. BMW up in Greer, does anybody want to guess how many vehicles they produce? Oh, everybody buckled up. They produce a new BMW every 61.7 seconds. Did he say 61.7 seconds? Did he? And we have 160 German companies in South Carolina. They're perfectionists. All these big companies are seeking perfection and excellence. And one bit of excellence begets another bit of excellence. That's why I'm so proud of the Darlington 500. You ought to see those people driving those cars. 1986, the margin of victory at that time was 400 miles. The margin of victory, the average speed was 125 miles an hour. The margin of victory was 2/1000ths of a second. Y'all see those, that's automotive engineering excellence, as well as some young folks out there. I was down there the other day, I think they have about 40 young men and one young woman. They got in those cars and they drove those things. And you had all the scientists and all these experts, everything's hooked up. You can tell the heart rate, the heat of the tires. This is not the old stock car racing going around the muddy road that we used to think of years ago. Things have changed. High tech is here. And South Carolina is right on the front of it. And that's where we've got to stay. We have plenty of electric power. We've run into a little stumble with the grid, with the building of two reactors. But that's why I'm going to Washington right now in a few minutes. It's one of the reasons to work on that and some other things. But we have all of these assets. We're a low union state, lowest in the country, about just over 1%. That's something that's interesting to these people who want to come. Now again, I'm talking about those who want to come here from outside and how they see us. We also, all these assets are available and to the people inside and with expansion. And we have been the beneficiaries of that, and we really don't see how important it is. But the others do. But the final thing, and this is the one that's most interesting to me, is the chairman of BMW was at the expansion 25 years up in Greer and said, of all these things that are important, the most important thing to him, and I've heard the same thing from other companies, but he said, to use his words, said, South Carolina is a handshake state. Said, when a man or woman in South Carolina gives you their word, they'll keep it. He said he's been all over the world. He's been all over the United States, not every one, but he's been looking for places to expand. And ladies and gentlemen, when you put in $100 million or $200 million, or in this case, $1 billion, as we just did in Berkeley County down the road on the expansion of the Volvo plant in Sweden, they haven't even opened up the original plant, and they're already expanding. That's about $2 billion. That's 2,000 jobs. Good, high-paying jobs will require some skills. We, with our technical colleges and with our Ready SC program, where we send people from the technical colleges around the world to look at their operations. If they're interested in coming here, we'll send people there to look at their plants, to understand their customs, understand their traditions, understand that they use robots, what kind of equipment, and come back to South Carolina and go to our technical college system and design a curriculum to train people to work those kind of machines and work in plants like that. You know how much it costs the company if it wants to come? Zero. You know how many states do that in the country besides us? Zero. So we're right on the edge. And the man up there says this is a handshake state. As a chairman of BMW, they give you a word, they'll keep you. And it's the people. They've all told me in different ways. It is the people of South Carolina that have them coming here. That is the most important thing. So I'm real proud of us. And it took a long time to get it. We've been through everything up and down since 1670. And we're right now on the cusp of the greatest prosperity that we've ever had before. Time of the Revolutionary War, this was the richest place among the colonies. And we need to keep on going. We need to keep on going. And so, the main thing we need to do is we have to educate the children. We need new ideas for that. We've got to keep the taxes low or we will not grow. The more you raise those taxes, the more we will throw. By the way, the reason I vetoed that gas tax is because of all the money that had been coming in over the years for that gas tax, through the gas tax, had been used on the roads, we wouldn't have the problem. But that money had been siphoned off somewhere around 40%, maybe 45%, maybe a little bit less, going to everything other than the roads. But now I have the authority given to me by the legislature to have more influence on how that money is spent. And I can't pick the members of the Highway Commission, but I can ask them to leave if they don't follow the priorities set by the Department of Transportation, which is good enough. Christie Hall, y'all probably saw Christie, when we were managing the hurricane, she's tops, her staff's top, they will come up with the priorities, and we're not to spend money on anything except the priority. It's your money, and you don't want it to be spent, whether it's on roads, anything else. We have to concentrate on what makes us strong. Spend money on keeping people safe and helping to make people stronger, and that's through education and health and all those sorts of things. So I'm finished. I wish I had more time. I think we might have time for
one or two questions.
Let me tell you, I'm looking for ideas. I believe in ideas, and I've got a lot of ideas from places. If I can find another state that's doing something good, we're gonna try to copy that or see how it works here. I was in Charleston at the Southern Region Energy Board, of which I'm a member of all the southern states. And everybody knows that a lot of the energy related industry people were there. Everything is coming to the south, to the southeast. Everything is coming right here where we are. And of all the states, we are the one that has not one or two of the things that they're looking for, but all of the things that they're looking for success. So if we don't mess it up by too many regulations on businesses, by too high taxes, we can keep on going. And prosperity will be another thing locked in. We're always competing with these other states. It's the only place in the world. You got 50 independent organizations called states. They're making laws and they're doing this and they're doing that and they're trying to get ahead of everybody else. So right now we're ahead. All these magazines and things are saying that we're either number one or number two on all these things. But as they say in NASCAR, if you ain't first, you're last. But I want to be first in everything. And if we manage to do that, we can ensure, to some extent, prosperity for our children, their children also be a model for the country. So that's my goal. And I hope you'll help me get there. Give me your ideas. Yes, sir.
On behalf of the city of Orangeburg, the city and the county work together very well. And when someone is looking at us, we pull all our resources together to try to make our accommodation for them to get here. And I'm just asking you to keep Orangeburg, the county, city on your radar. That if any company like what Greer has, like what Newberry has looked at us, we in between Columbia and Charleston, we are open because we are certainly ready to grow.
You see me standing here, don't you?
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Yes.
And that is, we always are mentioned to the companies that are looking, and there are a lot of them that are looking. That we got a lot of counties, a lot of them, a lot of fine cities, and those who go take a look are always impressed. And I just lately, if you travel around a little bit, you've probably seen a lot of out towns that used to be not very noticeable. Something's happening. I mean, we got a real renaissance. It's beautiful. They've always had that potential, but now they're really shining. So yes, I will do that. And I'm sure if somehow I forget something, you call me and let me know. One more, that lady in the pink. They're giving me the sign up here.
And I agree, we have a lot of good things, but I can't go with the opportunity to pass. My huge concern is our shortage of teachers. And that's a problem that, we don't have the feeder for our technical schools and what's coming on. Are there any short-term, this is an immediate crisis that we have with the shortage of teachers we have in our public schools. Is there something, and I know Secretary of the Department of Education is working on that too, but I would just certainly ask that be a priority, that we're going to have to come up with some solutions and work together to see what.
can't have schools without teachers. I don't think they can do it without teachers. We have a lot of teachers getting ready to retire. What I've learned over the years is in a lot of our more rural areas, it's very difficult to get teachers to go. For instance, in Marion County, which needs some new teachers, the younger teachers usually would be willing to go, and they stay a year or two, and then they go over to Oil Reef, Isaac, because there's more to do over there. They don't want to be in a place that doesn't have all the activity and choices that they have in another place. But yes, and my approach is new ideas. Of course, you always have to pay for talent. And, but also, we must remember that some of the old things are just not working as well as they did when they began. So I'm a big supporter of charter schools, of any kind of school choice, of homeschooling, anything that works for the children. The more I read and try to learn about it, I realize everybody's brain doesn't work the same. And there are different people. I found out that I learned to read through phonetics, that is, you sound the word out. But there's some young people who don't learn that way. They learn better just by looking at a word and knowing that says cat or Geronimo or whatever it is. That's what that means, and they don't go through the sounding out. But and there are probably other ways as well. That's just a small example. But we have to. In order to be a good teacher, you have to go to where the child is and bring them up with. That's what you do. You don't just tell them about it. You got to go get them and bring them up. So I'm looking for ways to do that. Ways that will change our educational system into a better one. But we cannot abandon the public schools, of course, because that's where most everybody goes. But if you got any ideas, write them down. Is that, y'all, I'm sorry, I'm out of time. Mr. President, we can talk again. But let's give 30 seconds, Mr. President. Yes, sir.
30 seconds. Although not a technical college, not a research one university, but you have one of the best opportunities for developing those teachers. Well, this institution right here in Orangeburg, one of the greatest turnarounds of the university system, South Carolina State University, that's known for developing the teachers, the principals, the superintendents of this state. Keep investing in South Carolina State University, Mr. Governor, and you will get that problem solved.
That's right. Well, thank you very much. We didn't get too much to regulations, but y'all are the ones that are running businesses and trying to grow you, the ones that are face to face. If you see something that's holding you back, write it down and send it to me. We'd love to have it.